Many of you may already know her. She's been involved in Bangalore for quite a while, and she's been working on issues of ecology for a very long time. And over the past decade, she has been working on, she's probably one of the few people in the country who've been working on issues of nature and ecology in urban areas, particularly in Bangalore. So welcome, Harini, and I'll hand it over to you.
Thanks, Amog. And trying to figure out a place to be where I don't get in the way of the things. This, trying to see, maybe this is, yeah, this is better. Okay. So, hello everyone, and a quick question before I start. How many of you are from Bangalore? Quite a few, and quite, okay, so this is a sort of a mixed audience. Let me see, for the people about from Bangalore, I hope I get to show you something more about your city that you haven't seen or heard of or thought of before. And for the people who are from the outside, I hope I get to introduce you to a slice of Bangalore, which is my city and a beautiful city, I think, despite of all of the changes that have been taking place. So I'll start with this lovely poem. For those of you who don't know who this is, so this is Shiva Bharat. This talks about Shivaji, the more famous Shivaji's father, Shaji. In the 1640s, in 1638, Shaji marched at the head of an army of the Bijapur Sultanate and took over Bangalore from one of the descendants of Kempegowda, who was called Magadi Kempegowda, because he then moved to Magadi. And he had a court poet called Parmanand, who wrote this Shiva Bharat, which is basically a story of the life of Shaji. And like all court poets do, this is somewhat of a eulogy of a king and his life and how he ruled. But what is very interesting for us is it's the oldest that we know written documentation of Bangalore and how it used to be. Shiva Bharat is a poem that was written sometime in the 1670s in Sanskrit and later translated to Marathi. But this describes Bangalore probably something around the late 1630s or early 1640s, around that time period, because as I said, Shaji took over in 1638. And this is a lovely translation that a friend of mine, Naresh Kirti from Nias, whom some of you may know, did this translation of the Sanskrit original. And I'd just like to read this out to you and for you to think through how Bangalore is now, or how it was even 20, 30 years ago. So it talks about Bingrul, which is what they called it. And it says that it was that matchless city with smart fortifications and towers. It resounded with the content coos of countless pigeons safe in their nests. And as we know, that's something that we still see in Bangalore. Animated by the calls of peafowl dashing in and out of skylights. Peafowl have, of course, disappeared from large parts of the city. Now they're still there in the Jalahalli areas. But they were there even in places like this and close to IISc 30 plus years ago. The city teemed with deep lakes. Each house was graced by a well. Fountains gurgled at every square, spouting a fine mist. Trees, thick with flower and shade, lined each home garden. The city was girdled by a bottomless moat glimmering with water and dotted with countless lakes, each as big as a sea. Picturesque parks, festooned with creepers swinging gaily in the breeze, all adorned the city. Shaji ruled here like Indra in his paradise, enjoying every sport and pastime with his kinsfolk. And you get this impression of a beautiful city where nature was very essential to the city. And even as recently as the late 1990s, you could relate to the city. It's in the past 15, 20 years that a lot of changes have come in. So going from this, the question I really want to look at is nature in the modern Indian city. Is there such a thing? Can there be such a thing? And what does the story of Bangalore really tell us about the types of change in nature and the kinds of trajectories that we see, and what scope or hope there is for the future, and where does such hope or scope lie? Right? So those of you who are from IIHS are very familiar with this map, but I know many of you are not. This is a nightlight satellite image of the world. And what this tells you is where the new urban areas are, or where the old urban areas are also. And you can see clearly that a lot of the urbanization is taking place in Asia. So India, China, very well lit up. We're already a world that is more than 50% urban, and we're going to get to the point where we're close to 75% urban by 2050, which is not very far away, right? If you look at the growth of cities right now, so 1990 to 2014, this is based on UN data, what this tells us is that the largest cities are not the fastest growing cities. So take India, for example. We have three of the 10 world's largest cities, which is no surprise, Delhi, Kolkata, and Mumbai. We also have three of the world's 10 fastest growing cities, Faridabad, Ghaziabad, Surat. Yeah? So the kinds of patterns of change that you see in these places are very different from the kinds of cities, old cities of the past. If you look at where are the new cities, the new growing cities, this big cluster in China, this big cluster in India, the yellows, the oranges and the reds, and this big cluster in different parts of Africa. Nigeria is, of course, the third fastest growing country in terms of urbanization, apart from India and China. But these, so the growth of cities in the future by 2050 is going to be dominated not by the US, not by Europe, but by Asia and by Africa, and especially by Asia. In Asia will be half the world's population. So if you look at 2050, and these are again estimates from the UN sources, 50% of the world's urban population is going to come from Asia. And Asia is actually, so of course the fastest growing is Africa, and it's in this steady thing. But Asia is going to be 50%. And do we know enough about urbanization in Asia? And there is arguably some similarities in terms of cultural context and ways of life in Asian cities, but we don't know enough about this. For instance, and these are just some sort of random snapshots from places in Singapore, in Japan, in different parts of India, and you know, there are different trajectories of urbanization. There are different trajectories, as I was discussing with a master class, about what people think of as sustainable cities. What you think of in Singapore, for instance, what they call a sustainable city, is very different from what India calls a sustainable city, very different from what China conceives of as a sustainable city. So what can we learn from Bangalore about how the Indian process of urbanization is going? And this is what I'm trying to do in Bangalore based on a program that I initiated in 2007 or thereabouts. We're looking at a diversity of different land uses and seeing how culture and land use and history influences biodiversity. We're also looking at history using a very long time sweep. So the oldest archival data we have is from inscriptions that goes back to the 6th century. I'm trying to look at that and changes from the 6th century to now. And finally, losing, because it's a city, and if you're looking at nature, nature is so influenced by culture and by society, you have to use mixed methods. So what you'll see here is an output of remote sensing, of spatial information, GIS analysis, of biodiversity studies, of a lot of interviews with people, of oral histories, of archival data. So all kinds of things that we're piecing together to try and tell a story of a city. My research in Bangalore, so as Amog was saying, I've studied forests and cities for a long time. And from 1993, which is when I began my research, we've been looking at a lot of forest change in different parts of South Asia as well as outside. And looking at how do communities act as positive agents of change as well as negative agents of change. I never looked at cities. I lived in cities. I live in Bangalore, but never thought of looking at the city. Always was in, and this is very typical of ecologists. You know, you tend to look at distant environments. But a few different things happened in 2006, 2007. And one of the things was I built a house and moved to a peri-urban part of the city. And there was a lovely lake, or what looked like it used to have been a lovely lake, Skycondrelli Lake, very polluted at that time in the part of the city where I lived. And a group of people in the community, which I also joined later, worked towards restoration of this lake, which is now a beautiful place with a lot of biodiversity, close to 100 different species of birds that we have now in the lake. Around the time my daughter was born, and this is my daughter along with a friend, Priya Ramasubban, who heads the trust that manages the lake, which many of you know, and her kids. So this was also very personal as, you know, sort of us as parents trying to see what kind of a neighborhood would the children in these peri-urban environments, which are very dystopic and dysfunctional in many ways, what can you leave behind for the future? You know, how do you, the central part of the city is relatively, I would say, functioning. You know your neighbors, you have a culture and set of interactions, you have a culture of green spaces. It's more like the Shiva Bharat story of Bengaluru. But the peri-urban city is very different. So how could you, you know, could we do something to work with the city? Around the same time, the old part of the city where I grew up, Jayanagar, JP Nagar, was the metro construction and a lot of proposed felling of about close to 1,000 trees, which was later limited due to intense civic protests by Hasiru by a lot of the local civic organizations. So again, being involved with those protests, seeing them working with those people, a lot of my students, for instance, did mapping of the trees and the tree felling in this area. So at this point, I started thinking about why is it that as an ecologist, I'm not studying these processes. I'm looking at something that's very distant, but interacting more as a citizen. And that's when looking at all of this came together, looking at a program of looking at nature in the city. And what happened along this journey is that my urban research is very different, as I'd like to show you through nature in the city, from the kinds of forest research I've done, which is more ecological and of course social also. But nature in the city has turned out to be an exploration that where the social and the ecological are very intimately intertwined. But I'd also say that somewhat surprisingly for me is that the personal and the scientific also became very intertwined in many ways. And that's why I was sort of asking, I tried to begin all of these talks by saying how many people are in the city and how many people are from the outside, because this is something that I like doing, introducing the city to you through this book and trying to see if there are other parts of the city that I can learn from all of you. So this is the book, Nature in the City. And what it does is it looks at stories of biodiversity in nature, but along with that of people and places, and all kinds of people in all kinds of places. So this is archival data from an old photograph of the Pete, the old part of the city. So you can see that it was dominated by coconuts, for instance. These are street vendors. What kinds of trees do they select to stay under? What kind of trees do slum kids like to play with? So trees serve all kinds of uses, not just green cover. And Belandur Lake, which there was a lot of protests motivated by local action. So it's an intertwining of these stories along with more scientific evidence. What through the book I'd like to share with you is a story of three main types of changes in ecosystems or changes in nature. And I'd argue that this is a story of Bangalore, but this could be the story of really any Indian city. And for those of you who are from other cities, it would be nice to talk about this later. So the first is, as the city urbanizes, how you lose an understanding of the city's geography, of the city's history, and the variation in the city. You start thinking of a city as a fairly homogeneous entity, whereas it once had a lot of variation. Now this is a map of the, so this is the BBMP boundary, the black. And what it's superimposed on is what you call a digital elevation model, which tells you the topography of the city. And if you look at the topography of the city, even if you look at archival data, when the British first came into Bangalore, one of the things they were told by people was Bangalore is divided into two kinds of geographies. It's the Malnad and the Maidan. The Maidan in Hindi, of course, means grassy plains. In Kannada, it's called the Bailu. And it is this part of the city, the eastern section. Grassy plains, relatively more rainfall, relatively fertile soil, a little bit thicker. The Malnad or Malenadu, the rolling hills are here, and there are three ridges that run roughly north, much more thorny cover. So it was what they called the jungle, scrub jungle, with a lot of wildlife. Now this difference, also geographers, if you look at old geography texts, say that the Malnad got less rainfall because it was in the rain shadow of the Western Ghats, and the Maidan got more rainfall. Now this is something that needs to be studied in greater detail. We partly have the data sets, partly we just don't even have the data sets to study this in terms of a distributed network of stations. But essentially what this tells you was there were two completely different geographies. And this would dictate to some extent how people settled the landscape and the kinds of livelihoods and lifestyles that they employed. So one way of seeing this is to look at where did people choose to settle. Now, what do we know about the old history of settlements in Bangalore? The first thing we know is that there are megalithic stone tombs around some parts of the city. So especially if you go really north of the city, so north of the current airport to areas near Avati, you see a lot of these megalithic stone tombs dated to about 6,000 to 8,000 years ago. Don't know anything about who these people were, why they settled, what they did. Don't know. But the next thing you know is there are large caches of coins discovered around the BC to AD transition. And old historians that looked at this say that the kinds of diversity of coins and the numbers of coins they found suggest that Bangalore must have been an important overland trade route, an intersection of routes. Otherwise, you wouldn't have found this diversity of coins. Again, we don't know much about that. What we do know is from about the 6th century onwards, you start seeing inscriptions of various kinds on copper plates and on stones. These could be land grants, these could be hero stones, these could be other kinds of documentation. But you can use those to tell you when a particular area was either first mentioned or was first settled. And I've used these to try and map what kinds of settlements you had in 4 major dynasties. The Gangas, the Cholas, the Hoysalas, and then the Vijayanagara Empire. Of course, Kempe Gowda was part of the Vijayanagara Empire when the modern city came in. And if you look at this, what you see is that if you look at the original, so you start with, I've lost the first map, but the first map is that of the Ganga dynasty, and that's 6th to 9th century AD, and you see that most of the settlements are all in the Bailu, the Maidan areas. And it's very clear that in that, you know, if you start entering into a landscape like this, which is a bit formidable, there is no large water body, it's a semi-arid region, you would enter the Maidan areas, because what you would do is take, so there are documentations of how they would build lakes. They would scoop out the mud, clear out the jungle, and do rainwater harvesting. Right? What happens later? The Cholas come in, and then they start moving a little bit more into this area. Then during the time of the Hoysala dynasty, there's a burst of tank construction. And the Hoysalas are, of course, big tank builders across all of South India. And Sandra, you know, so many place names that end in Sandra in Bangalore. Sandra means Samudra, which means large body of water. So Singha Sandra, Malla Sandra, Juna Sandra, all of these indicate that there were large tanks, of course, there. But there are a variety of other things. There's also Kere, which is, of course, a lake. Kunte, which is a smaller body of lake. Kundi, which is another small body of water. So there are various kinds of lakes. Some of them were used for cattle washing. Some of them were used for more domestic purposes. Some were large lakes, which were Samudras. And you can see this entire cascade. You can also see but that by now people start extending into the Malnad because they are running out of space. And finally, by the time of the Vijayanagara Empire before Kempe Gowda, I've stopped where Kempe Gowda comes in, you find that if you put all of these maps together, there were 75 villages at least in this landscape surrounding Bangalore. So when you think of the sort of Wikipedia story of Bangalore, which is Kempe Gowda came into this barren land, virgin land, and he saw this hare chasing a hound, nothing else was going on in this landscape, and he said, this is the landscape where I can build a town. Of course, he must have been a visionary to create a town like this, but there was also a lot of thriving, you know, activity in this area which supported the creation of a market town. And in fact, when he came in, Achyuta Devaraya was the emperor of the Vijayanagara Empire at that point, and he gave him a jagir of several villages around this area as a reward for having created a market town and extended the empire here. So it could not have been done de novo. But what does this tell you? This inscriptions, I mean, these just the geographies, just the location. But you can also read the text of the inscriptions. And the text tells you, here's a typical Maidan inscription. It's from Kempapura, which is a place close to Belandur Lake. It's a land grant. And again, this is very typical of these areas. They talk about lakes. And look at the landscape that they describe. The tank of the village. And all the wetlands and the dry lands. The dry lands are the millet construction above the village, above the tank, that is upstream of the tank. The downstream of the tank where the water is, comes out and there's irrigated landscape is of course the wetlands or the paddy, right? But they are also describing a three-dimensional landscape. They also talk about the wells below and the trees above. And so there's this three-dimensional landscape, it's semi-arid and water is extremely important. And so you're not thinking about just what you can see on the surface, but also what keeps life going in that area. And life going as in agriculture going, because these are settled landscapes, and that's a particular kind of agriculture. So this description is broadly repeated in inscription after inscription. Malnad, the hills, you see a very different landscape. What would you do in a hill with thorny scrub jungle with a lot of wild beasts, where soil is thin, it's not that fertile, you don't get that much water, it's very difficult to pull out the boulders and do rainwater harvesting in these areas, right? What you get is a lot of stories of hero stones, heroes who die in wild boar attacks, wild elephant attacks, because the lifestyle, the livelihood there is pastoralism. what you do is you have a lot of cattle, send them into the jungle and go with them into the jungle. So for example, you have an inscription in 1060 CE which is talks about Ramadeva who was killed by a wild boar. From Kanakpura, someone who's killed by a tiger, another person killed by a tiger, another person and his dog were killed by a boar. The dog is also mentioned in the story, in the inscription. Some of these are tragic because they also come with sati stones. So sometimes somebody dies in an attack and then his wife is also immolated, so there's a sati stone associated with these. There are hero stones that describe cattle raids. So one battle against the other, the victor goes to heaven, or sometimes he dies but he's still supposed to have gone to heaven, he's not the victor of the battle, but very extensive stones, but it gives you a picture of a very different landscape. And even today, a lot of these stones, these inscriptions of the Malnad come from Kanakanhalli, which is today's Kanakpura, which is close to the Marankata Wildlife Sanctuary and still has all of these. It has the boar, it has the elephant, it has, you know, the same kinds of wildlife. It is the area where wildlife is concentrated. So what you see with these two, what you essentially see is that Bangalore has a structure, of course, so this is the standard map of the three watersheds of Bangalore. But this entire region, the Hebbal Valley and the Vrishabhavati Valley are essentially the Malnad. And the Kormangla Chalgata Valley is the Maidan. And we don't think of these as geographically separate. And something that those of you who are older residents of Bangalore than even me will know, remember, is that Bangalore used to be much more topographically complex than it is now, right? I remember parts of the city which were densely populated otherwise, but there was one hillock that was left because you didn't know how to build on it. And now, of course, with technologies, those have all been flattened and you have apartment complexes on them. Similarly, there were a lot of wetlands that were left alone in the central parts of the city that have now been filled in. So topography, ecology, of course history doesn't matter, but rainfall, all of these don't matter anymore. Builders and planners don't even know this, and most people don't know the difference between the Malnad and the Maidan. It's interesting that the early British documents, when they come and say that this is one of the first things they were told about Bangalore, that there's the Malnad and the Maidan, these are two different parts of the city. This has gone away from common parlance. I was not aware of it till I started reading these documents, and I'd been working on the city for a long time. Right? So today, builders and planners have completely forgotten this and don't pay attention to it. Except that the topography and the ecology still is important in times of climate stress. So for instance, during this year's summer, which is one of the worst summers in the history of Bangalore, and for a very extremely hot and unusually hot Asian summer, climate change plus urbanization, right? Several degrees hotter than it has been for a long time. Part of that is when you're building, it's where you're building. If you're building in granite areas and rocky areas and cutting down the trees and filling in the lakes, it's going to become hotter. Similarly, flooding. You know, when you're thinking of a time of extreme floods, again, you've been building on the wrong areas that you should not have been building on. So this is something we've been completely forgetting about, but it's very important. The second story, so the first story is that of the fact that we have forgotten the geographies. We think of the city as a homogeneous space, but it's not. The second story is that as you urbanize, the other thing you do is you break your local cycle of use. You start importing water, energy, food from outside, you send your waste again long distances, and therefore you stop thinking about sustainability because you're not locally dependent anymore. This is a map that tells you about the growth of Bangalore from Kempegowda's time, which was a small place, to this huge area. Now, how has the city grown so large? Obviously, it can't be from looking at, you know, depending on its local resources. It's grown by swallowing things from the areas around. And of course, Bangalore is not unique. I was again talking to the master class. And though we are in a world that is more than 50% urban, cities or urban settlements are less than 1% of the world's land cover. So in terms of the area, they're actually small. The sphere of influence is massive because they draw from so many places and they send out to so many places. Okay? How does Bangalore fare with this? So what was the story of Bangalore between Kempegowda, Shaji, Haider, Tipu, and the British? Very little documentation in terms of the maps of actual distribution. We have some archival data, a lot of oral histories and myths floating around. But the earliest map that we have is 1791, Third Anglo-Mysore War. Tipu actually loses Bangalore to the British for about a year and a half and then ransoms it back. Again, dies, of course, in 1799 and then the British take over. But in 1791, the British come in, and what do? The first thing they do is they draw landscape paintings and they sketch maps. So you can use those to reconstruct some of the city's history. Two things that you get. One is that there was a series of lakes. Second thing is that it was a semi-arid area, so of course it had few trees, very few trees. What kinds of trees do you have? Around the Pete, you had the set of thorny trees, which was the fortification, of course, which, so every city had a thorny hedge. This is supposed to be Shikakai. So it may have been trees, it may have actually been plants. You had these, which are orchards clearly, because they, you know, looking at their shape, they were what were called totas. And in the Indian tradition, the tota or the orchard is not very separable from the park. It was a mixed thing. It was partly tota and partly place of recreation. And then, of course, along one major road, you seem to have some trees, but it's largely open, right? Then the British come in about 1810, 1811, they start the cantonment. Cantonment expands, and then about 1840s or so, you start seeing a discussion of climate change in the literature. They say Bangalore is getting very hot. We used to have fireplaces. Sepoys couldn't fire their muskets in the morning because their fingers would be benumbed with the cold. Now, you know, the sepoys can fire their muskets anytime, and you don't need the fireplaces. We need to cool down the city. We're not able to stay here. So the British start this massive tree plantation program. And of course, they have access to a palette of species across the world. So they get in rain trees, they get in copper pods, they get trees from Madagascar, trees from Brazil, trees from different parts of the world. And they plant them across the city with the idea that they follow of serial blossoming. So it's British planting taking an idea from Indian literature of Kalidasa, which is called Ritu Samhara. So that was an old Sanskrit garden, for instance, which was the idea of serial blossoming. In every season, you would have something to blossom. That's harder to do if you're relying on native trees because they tend to blossom during one season. It's much easier when you have a palette like the British and you can draw from any part of the world. But from 1791, therefore, by 1888, you have a lot more trees. And it's not too much of a surprise that most of the trees are outside the Pete. They're actually in the cantonment area because that's where the British focused, obviously, their attention on. So cantonment and the city or the Pete were two completely different areas. The Pete, if you look at old maps, they had a lot of coconuts. But apart from this, not much other types of vegetation. So densely planted areas. And they increased the number of lakes. So Alsur Lake was there, but expands in size. There's Sankey Lake, there's the Miller's Tank series, a number of lakes that they create. Now by 1890, Sankey Lake is constructed, and Colonel Sankey says, this is it. This is the last lake I can create in Bangalore. We've run out of space. All the suitable places have either been converted into lakes or have already existing populations that are built, so it's built up spaces. Between 1889 and 1892, there's a series of droughts. And the city has grown and grown and grown, so there's not enough water to support the populations. At that time, the Mysore Maharaja, because the Indian part of the city is facing severe droughts and is not able to cope with this, says that I'm going to start this, and so this all the modernization programs of the Mysore state also, saying that I'm going to get piped water in and from the Arkavati area. So there's this series of dams of three lakes, and they start the idea of getting piped water in. At that time, the British resident writes to the Maharaja and says, I'll give you some lakes. So for instance, they hand over Sampangi Lake to the Pete and say, just give us piped water as well. So piped water now, which is originally planned for the Pete, comes to the entire city. At this point, you see a huge change in the narrative around lakes. In the narrative around wells also. I don't have a map here of the wells, but by 1888, just in this area, which is the old part of the city, there were 1,500 open wells. This is not your small well in a house, individual wells. These are open community wells, the large ones, 1,500. And now I think we did a survey, there are something like 40 or 45, and the few that are there, most of them are, I mean, they're not, none of them are functional really. They're just there, they've, you know, broken down in some form. But 1,500. They also had kalyanis, or these large tanks, which were outside temples also, but surrounding these lakes. So there was this entire series of water systems that were used. As soon as piped water comes in the archives, you can see a change in the narratives around water. From being life-giving, from being sacred, from being places that are productive and need to be restored, they suddenly become waste areas to be drained. They're areas that are sources of floods. They are areas that are cesspools for malaria. And interesting, so when there were plague outbreaks, if a family was found with a corpse of somebody with the plague, the entire family would be transported to quarantine areas. So they started dumping corpses in wells. And the idea that you would throw corpse in a well is an ultimate sign of how little water means to you at that point, because it's polluted in an Indian tradition, not just physically, but also, you know, you will sort of spiritually, you will not use that water body again. So this entire narrative changes suddenly around this time, and a lot of the wells start getting closed. So Sampangi Lake, for instance, which was closed soon after this time, there are contestations in the archives around this time. And till then it was well preserved. During this time, the British actually argue that they need to drain the lake for a number of reasons. The lake is flooding the breweries and the bungalows. They would like the lake to be drained so that the poor regiment which has been here for 3 years has not had a chance to play polo, and they need to play polo before they go back to the UK. And at the same time, there's a group of 95 Tigalars, which are the local orchard group, the horticulturalists from this area, writing a petition to the Mysore Maharaja saying that you can't drain the lake, our orchards depend on this lake. And the Mysore Maharaja backs them up, saying these are my taxpayers. So you can see this entire conflict between the way the lake becomes a utilitarian resource and the way it becomes a sort of a nuisance value because it's flooding and all you would like is some grassy area to play polo. Don't know what happens to this debate at that point, so the archives sort of suddenly become incomplete. We don't know how this was solved. But we do know that the British regiment played polo a couple of years later, and we do know that the lake was eventually drained. So it seems like the utilitarian value of the lake came far below the other kinds of nuisance values of the lake. Trees, on the other hand, still need to be used, right? Because this is a hot area, and you need shade. So look at 1888, and then I'll show you 2015. Let's go back. 1791. 1888, more people, more trees, more lakes. 2015, many more people, more trees, hardly any lakes. This is your, so it's a classic example really of once you lose your local loop of dependence, it's almost a textbook example of then how you stop valuing nature. Unless you use it, you don't need it. And it's interesting that if you look at when a lot of the lake groups that are interested in lake protection came up in the city, so which is about 2007 onwards, it's around the time that the peri-urban part of the city at least started facing a huge groundwater crisis. And the price of water tankers, I remember during those 2-3 years between 2004 to 2007 almost doubled. And people were talking about how do you get water, you can't get water, you pay so much for water, or we need to do rainwater harvesting, what happened to our lakes? And that's really been a trigger, a major trigger for protection of a lot of these lakes in this city. Along with, of course, issues of flooding and other things, but the lack of availability of water was a big one. Of course, you see a lot of trees here, but I must also stress that this is a map of 2015, and in the past 20 years, as we know, we've lost well over 100,000 trees. We don't know how many. So the map of the city, even 20 years ago, would have had a lot of trees. And more trees. But the thing is really that you can't import your shade, whereas you can import your water. So it gives you the sense when you break your local loop of what you miss and what you decide to value and keep. The third trend. So the first one was the fact that as a city urbanizes, it becomes homogeneous, right? You stop thinking of differences between the north, south, the high and the lowlands. The second one was the loss of the local loop of dependence leads to destruction. The third trend, which is again common to all Indian cities, is that when you do protect, you protect with a very simplified view of nature. I'll explain what that means. And that goes towards simplification of biodiversity, simplification of social uses, and therefore a lot of social exclusion. So look at lakes, for instance. Lakes in Bangalore were used in diverse ways. We used for cattle grazing, cattle washing, used for dhobis to wash clothes, used for personal use, personal washing of clothes and domestic uses. And when they dried up, there were a lot of other domestic uses. They supplemented local nutrition and livelihoods. So when lakes dried up, women would pick these greens, which are called vanaganesappu, and use them. And they were very valuable nutritional supplements. And as well as there were traditional, so the local varieties of fish would flop around actually in the mud as the lake waters receded. And so that would become protein. And this helps in resilience in a very interesting way, because there is special, so there are good years of rainfall and there are bad years of rainfall. When you have a good year, you have a lot of water and you have crops. When you have a bad year, you get greens and you get more fish that you can pluck out. So there are in each year, depending on the climate, you have some kinds of livelihood strategies, some kinds of subsistence strategies, something to eat. How are we dealing with lake rejuvenation today? The focus is very much on groundwater recharge, recreation, nature watching. And as a result, do I have these? So as a result, what you typically have with many of these lakes is signboards which say no fishing, no plucking flowers, no breaking branches, no swimming, no pets, no varieties of different things. And what that leads to really is exclusion of a lot of people who have always been using these places. So you do get protection, but it's a simplified kind of social protection. It leads to a lot of exclusion. The other downfall of this is actually ironically nature, because when you're looking at simplified uses, there is a great resistance to planting native multifunctional tree species. So for instance, if you take BBMP guidelines for the lakes, you're not really permitted to plant fruiting trees in these lakes because people will fight about the fruit. That is the state reason. Or it's very difficult to maintain because there's a lot of fruit that falls and it creates a mess and people will protest. And so what can you plant then? Pretty recreational species, maybe a few species like neem and honge. So now pretty much those of you in Bangalore know that all the plantations of new trees are neem and honge. And I love those two species, but you cannot have an entire city full of two species of trees. The one thing we found with our biodiversity studies of Bangalore is it has a much higher species diversity than many other cities across the world. So that is something we really need to protect. Again, give you some other examples of the same thing. You have tops, gundu tops. So these were these village forests around the periphery of Bangalore and planted from Hyder Ali's time and then picked up a lot by the Mysore state later by the Wadiyas. And the idea was that each village would have a set of trees, jackfruit, mango, tamarind, some banyan, some sacred uses, but largely again the idea was multifunctionality. So it would give you fruit, it would give you firewood. You had permissions to cut one tree in 100 every year or every 2-3 years for some kinds of construction uses, and you would replant. What happens to these tops now? Of course, many of them become degraded areas, right, which nobody can use. Some of them become public utilities. So the idea, once it becomes a state place, is it's exchangeable. It's a public function that it serves. And therefore, the public function is replaced. So we looked at gundu tops and I think there are about 85 that we've been looking at, and about 80 of those, if anything, have all disappeared because they've become panchayat offices, bus stops, resettlement program locations, all kinds of places, but they're public utilities, schools, no trees. The few places that they survive, interestingly, have been reconverted to landscape parks. So Doddagubbi is one very nice example, had a lovely park, had a lovely gundatop, and the village is now actually step forward to re-landscape it as a park, again with different kinds of species. Similarly, wooded streets. This is KR Road from the 1930s, had banyan trees. And we were talking to the bamboo weavers who used to live, one of the bamboo weavers here said that, for instance, when his mother fell sick, and they were living across on the side of the road, when she fell sick, his father used to take the sap from the bamboo, from the banyan tree, and mix it with the previous day's ragi mudde, the ragi balls. And she would swallow that first thing in the morning, and he said, her cough never became deteriorated to the point she had to go to a doctor. She never went to a doctor in her whole life. And that's a use of banyan trees I didn't know about, and I hadn't heard anybody who had told me this. So these were multifunctional trees. Now they've become high-speed roads with very few trees. Again, the plan, which is very clear, BBMP plans for tree planting, is not to plant any fruiting trees. So all our traditional Indian roadside trees, tamarind, banyan, all of these other trees that had some uses are not planted anymore. The focus is on planting ornamentals. Lal Bagh kinds of parks. Let's look at parks. Parks, as I said, were orchards and were gardens. Lal Bagh was always a fruit orchard where different varieties of fruits and grafting was carried out. It had Tipu Sultan's famous mango trees somewhere, I think, in this corner. And ornamentals become these kinds of recent parks. Lots of grass. Ironically, it requires pumping of groundwater and tankers to come in every summer, and there are no tree parks anymore. These are all ornamentals. You don't even plant medicinal plants. Occasionally, you have medicinal plants, but most, look at all of these. You don't even have flowers because they're, where is my pointer? Yeah. Look at all of these. These are variegated, right? You have flowers, they only look pretty at some points of the year. You have variegated, you can trim them. It's not messy. So the whole simplification again. Private spaces, similar trend. You've gone from rich home gardens where you had all kinds of plants which were used and cooked with. So these are lentils of various kinds growing as creepers, to apartments with manicure. The focus is on royal palms and certain kinds of species, and again, not on multifunctional use. So that's the third trajectory, that you get simplification of biodiversity along with simplification of social use, because the construction of nature, the way you think about nature, has changed. It's a very simplified set. And a very simplified set of people who are driving these changes, really, which is behind this. But what's the way forward then? So finally, the way forward that you see is a few places, surprising places, I'd argue, that are maintained in the city as multifunctional urban commons in a very natural and very organic way. What are these? One good place is slums. So if you look at slums across Bangalore, very interesting. They have the highest proportion of native species. They have the highest proportion of used species. So to give you an example, if you look at parks, 80% of the trees in parks are exotic. If you look at slums, 65% of the species in slums are native, which also means that they're not going to be planting variegated. I've actually never seen a variegated plant in a slum. It's typically something that you can use. They do plant ornamentals, but very carefully selected, because they also want something pretty which is different from their neighbors, and are fiercely proud of their gardens. Small gardens in tiny patches. It could be, you know, in paint buckets, in old sacks, in utensils with holes in them, but very carefully protected, and serve multiple uses. So nutritional purposes, for instance, which are very important for kids and nutritional diversity. Medicinal, you know, other kinds of sacred uses, so community spaces. What typical trees that you find in a slum are coconut, are the drumstick, again, which is used for multiple things, or are sacred trees. They're used for livelihoods. They're used, so you have the typical tire puncture sign, which is your tree, you know, the tire on a tree. But you also have other kinds of livelihoods, basket weaving, etc., which is done under these. And they're social spaces, because all your washing is outside, all your cooking is outside. So you'll see women and children doing all of this under the shade of a tree, which means they're social spaces for congregation and for exchange with your neighbors. So these are really places where, you know, biodiversity survives without exclusion in a very organic fashion. And it's also multiple things. You know, one of the slums that I'd gone to, and I'll never forget this, the lady in Bhatrali slum, and she had aloe vera in a place, which is next to a lake, which is an extremely polluted lake, with a lot of snakes. No water, there's a well that is extremely polluted. She gets the water from a long distance in pots to water this small patch of garden, which is on the side, because she says if in front of her house the snakes come in. I said, why do you go to so much trouble? And why are you selecting these species that you select? So one of the species was aloe vera. And she said, my daughter planted it, so I look after it for her. She's now married and has gone away. And she said in Kannada, and then I'll translate for those of you who don't know Kannada. She said, nimmanta aur parlarige hogtare, nammanta aurge ide parlar. Which means, for people like you, you go to the parlor for face packs and for beauty facials. But for us, this is our parlor. So this is our garden, this is our kitchen, and this is our parlor. And then you start thinking about the multiple kind of roles that nature serves, which is also an aesthetic and a way of life, but in a very different way of life than you're thinking of recreation, right? Another place is sacred places. And this is from the beautiful Nandi Tirtha temple in Malleshwaram, which was lost. It was buried under the ground and nobody knew that it existed, till somebody started noticing that it keeps seeping, and it was actually going to be converted into an apartment complex. And they found that this area needed to be, you know, so the communities got together and protected it and restored it. And you can see a pigeon drinking water from here, which is why I have this. But we've done extensive studies across the cemeteries in Bangalore, across the temples, churches, mosques, diverse faiths. Some of the cemeteries, especially, for instance, on Hosur Road, have the largest and most beautiful heritage trees with lovely resting, roosting sites for a variety of, you know, kites and other kinds of raptors. And they're also very resilient, because some are formal spaces. So churches, temples, mosques, of course, would have institutional methods of protection. But there are also things like cemeteries, or just what you call an ashwatthakatte, this platform with a neem and a people, which communities maintain in a very organic fashion. Sometimes it's the original community, so people who are Bangalorean for a long time. And then you suddenly find an ashwatthakatte with, for instance, a group of, let's say, Marwadi shopkeepers who moved in recently, but they've taken over maintenance of this. And when a tree falls and dies, it's replaced by another tree. So very organic ways of protection, leaving rice out with ghee, leaving some sugar out, leaving milk out for species. So there are a lot of traditions of species protection and biodiversity. So what does this tell us? What does the story of Bangalore tell us? Essentially, three trajectories of ecosystem change. One is that you have degradation and disappearance, so you lose the local cycle. The second is you protect nature, but you simplify it in a manner that is it nature really? You know, you're not very sure about. It's a commoditized form of nature, essentially. And the third is the urban commons, which I argue is the way forward for Indian city. Maintaining this as a multifunctional resource that communities can use, which gives you space for provisioning, for foraging from this, as well as traditional cultural services, for old and new uses. Because slums and sacred spaces, you could argue that, for instance, sacred spaces might be the original areas of a city. But slums definitely aren't. They're full of migrants. And how is it that they protect nature so intensely? And so what? Is this a story about one city? What does it tell you about India? So this is India with its rapid urbanization, and what hope do we have for the future of nature in Indian cities? We know we need nature in Indian cities. There are, of course, some that argue that cities are for people and you can have greater protection outside. And I've heard some even very sort of ecologists say that urbanization is a good thing because it's going to depopulate the India's rural landscapes where the trees will grow back. And you can just have concrete in cities and keep that aside. But you can't. You have to be there. And you know, trees are one of the best, most effective ways of reducing air pollution. You want some kind of groundwater infiltration in cities which are groundwater dependent, so you need wetlands. You have to stop flooding, so you need lakes to connect those and to absorb all of that water that comes in during rainfall. You need nature for a variety of other uses. You need nature for, you know, so all kinds of things. Reducing obesity, reducing stress levels, making people happy, making people, communities come together. So in its specifics, this is the story of Bangalore, but in the broader themes that I've described, this is any Indian city. In conversations with people, interestingly, not just Indian cities, you know, if you talk to people from London, they'll tell you about parallels in Swedish cities, in Taiwan, you know, you see these are some of the sort of, these are very sort of common trends, all of these three kinds of trends, except for the urban commons, which tends to be more a global south, I think, kind of city thing. But certainly, definitely, it's applicable, I'd argue, to all cities in India, because we have a cultural heritage that involves nature. So even in the most densely populated cities across India, you'll find a road devoid of trees on either side, and suddenly in the middle you'll have a sacred tree, a people tree or something like that, and all the traffic is going around it, right? Nobody's going to touch that tree. So these are certain traditions that you find across South Asia, actually. So what do you do then with this? Nature in Bangalore has witnessed a lot of changes, and the organic connect that we once had with nature has now disrupted. What you see from Parmanand's Shivabharat, the description of Bangalore that I started with, was there, I'd argue, even till the late 1990s, but it has largely disrupted, especially in the peri-urban parts of the city. Where it does survive and thrive is in places like slums and lakes and sacred spaces, which are managed as commons and used by communities, not just protected for non-consumptive uses. And this can show us a path forward for the future. But how does this interface with India's urban paths for the future? One thing we are focused on is driving urbanization and looking at smart cities. Now, what is a smart environment in cities? Unfortunately, if you look at the discussions, there are very few discussions of the smart environment in smart cities. The few discussions that you do have prioritize nature for its recreational value and for its regulating services, regulating air pollution, cleaning up the air, cleaning up the water. It doesn't talk about anything else. So what it does is still give you targets. We need to plant 100,000 trees in the city. What kinds of trees are you planting? Obviously, that makes a big difference to how what kind of nature you get in the city. It also ignores completely the fact of urban commons. If you look at all the kind of policy documents that you have in India, they talk about commons as though they only exist in rural environments. There are no commons in cities. And this is not just pertaining to India. If you look at literature around the world, there is barely any focus on urban commons or discussion that there can be such a thing as an urban commons, especially in the global south context. The discussions there are come from places like Sweden or Oslo, where they're actually trying to do re-commoning. But I'd argue that urban commons are very important for a sense of place. So the few discussions now that I've been having with people who come into the city, it seems like if you've been in the city for about 5-6 years, and you have a place that you go to which is a place of nature, it gives you a sense of place and a reason for a collective to come around. And once a collective takes up one issue, it could be lake protection. Many of the lake protection groups have, you know, some have been successful, many have been unsuccessful in getting, in terms of getting the lake protection underway. But that doesn't really matter because they've got together to do other things. They're looking at solid waste, they're looking at traffic, they're looking at health, they're looking at education, they're looking at a number of issues in their neighborhood. You get to meet your neighbors and you form small groups that look at other things. So it fosters a sense of collective action, a sense of social capital, which is very much missing from our cities, which is a real problem. And it helps to some extent, despite the exclusion that happens, it helps to bring other, you know, slowly over time when you engage, you get a sense of different actors and you start talking. And I do see movements in that direction. So finally, I'll end with this, just saying that we need some more crosstalk here. Ecologists have never looked at cities. They look at forests, they look at more attractive places. Urban scholars don't look at ecology. You can see a number of lovely books about cities, but they treat nature either like it doesn't exist or a footnote on the side, not through the lens of nature. So we need more conversations like these. We need places where ecologists and urban scholars come together and actually talk about cities to see how you can look at cities as organic entities where the social and the ecological are part of the same system. And we need to see how you can look at cities as functional commons in terms of the policy and planning realm, because this is something that is completely missing. If you look at urban foraging, and that's something we've been trying to do, looking at urban policies across the world, foraging is either never spoken about, or in practice, even more dangerous, treated as illegal. So you can be arrested for urban foraging in most cities if you forage in the public environments. So for instance, New Orleans, there was a tradition of basket weaving, which people did from reeds that were plucked from the sides of the roads. But as the city has developed post-Katrina and now has become gentrified, some old parts of the city, so industries and private developers have come in and taken large areas where the reeds used to go in. And now when you go into that area, which used to be a commons, you can get arrested, for instance, for you. Similarly, there might be other parts of the world where, so there are, these are parallels with different areas where you can, so South Africa, there are stories about, interesting research looking at urban to rural dependence on the commons and showing how even in South African cities, you have a lot of dependence. But if you're seen collecting from public areas in many places, in practice, if you're the wrong kind of person, which means a poor person, you can be fined. So urban foraging is in practice treated as illegal, and you can't have urban commons without urban foraging. So how do you fix this is a much larger issue to engage with. And it's an issue that impacts resilience to climate change and it impacts resilience to urbanization. So nature in the city, we need to go beyond thinking of it as just the resilience of the city. You need nature for flooding, for air pollution, but also for the people in the city and especially for the most disadvantaged, because you need nature in the city for their resilience as well. I'll end with this and take questions.
Just one small point. Bengaluru was really giving a lot of importance to preservation of nature and all that. At some point of time, it changed with times. And again, there is a sense of renewal in that particular aspect. But in India now, we are building a few cities from scratch. One of the examples is Amaravati. Where, unfortunately, what we are doing is we are going by the example of the modern cities like Singapore or any other place with full of high rises and all that. And that is leading to a situation where we are destroying by in trying to build smart cities. They are calling it a smart city now. Smart cities, we are destroying what is available naturally to us. In terms of wetlands, in terms of water bodies, in terms of fertile soil and all that. I think if we extend this idea or concept of commons managed by communities, the local communities there, and try to retain that as part of interspersed urban spaces, not a continuous urban sprawl, then I think it would be a much better idea and it will be, it maybe it will become a big, better example for the world to follow. Because this is one of the concepts which India can offer, not any other country in the world. And we are missing out on that in our blind attempt to blindly adhere to the Western standards. I'd like to have some comments from you on that.
I completely agree. So the smart city concept, if you ask me, is ecologically foolish because it does not look at any of these issues. Amravati is an interesting one. I don't know if you have seen, there's a group of alternate architects who come up with that.
I've seen that, yes. But unfortunately, they have not even been given an audience concerned authorities making so many attempts.
No.
And that clearly shows that we are not prepared to set an example or a benchmark for the entire world to follow. But we want to blindly follow this. Probably we want to go through the entire cycle of misery and unhappiness that we are making and then find a solution for that. I don't know. We could have leapfrogged that and showed the way out.
If there was the will to look for something. True. No, if you look at the fact that it is a land grab of on the most fertile farmland delta areas that you want to go and then build cities. It is such a ill-founded place.
So that's supposed to be one of the richest areas, Krishna Delta, and we are not bothered about it.
No.
It's a pity.
I hope you will definitely be there and driving things forward. But I'm an optimist, so I'm still going to hope that things are going to get better. And I think there are so many good people fighting incredible fights, and some of them being successful, that hopefully there is some change. I think as the voices aggregate, I didn't expect to see 5,000 people out for a steel flyover Beda, for instance. So that's real progress. Now, if you think of how many people have been there in the previous kinds of.
That's the reason I asked you about the future of Bangalore.
Now there are enough environmental policies that we push.
I would like to you to throw light, including the government's role, not just the environmentalist, taking into view that also. What do you feel?
So my only sense is if citizens push enough, that's when action happens. Or how do I put it? It's not necessary that action happens, but if we don't push, action will never happen. It's only when people come out in large enough numbers to protest and to make that some change happens. So even the lakes, for instance, about the city, the harder part has always been to deal with tree felling across roads, right? But at least for lakes, whenever groups have pushed to very great extents, that's when something has happened. So.
We have to find some sort of a system whereby we compel these people to follow certain rules. It is required. Because otherwise, Bangalore's efforts in reviving the lakes or protecting the trees, the wayside trees and all these things are really going to be, I don't say it's going to be futile, but it's going to be quite tough, the path ahead.
I can't disagree with any of that. All I can say is that we have to do something because we're already in this situation. It's going to get worse. But Kaikonrelli Lake, a good example is 2 weeks ago when the bund was broken by a landowner behind and left encroachments let in. The police station wouldn't record the complaint.
Probably for the first time.
Yeah, 50 plus people went to the police station and they refused to record the FIR till, another week, and then they finally. So things are stacked against this, but I really don't think there's any other way except to organize.
No, that is true. The only thing is,
for the kind of effort that people are putting,
absolutely,
there must be some more support from the institutions also,
absolutely, absolutely,
the governmental institutions. And they should build, for example, if they make the lakes, they declare all lake areas as heritage sites first. Give that legal backing that is required. And see that any encroachment, any modification, any alteration on the lake bed or around the lake bed, as per the NGT order,
is not permitted.
I think that is going to really give a lot of fillip to the efforts that a lot of concerned citizens are putting in Bangalore.
Very inspiring talk. So I think, I mean, I have a comment and a question. In terms of comment, I think that questions of nature are extremely complex when it comes to reining them or, you know, protecting them, territorializing mm-hmm. them in some form. Because especially even if you take the case of rivers, they meander. Lakes, they will change their form, their topography. So, I mean, it's very difficult to really settle it as a question of law or protection in terms of, which is why the urban commons, where the commons decides how and where it can move, seems a more viable route for the future. But I think that somewhere we need to very strongly disconnect from the fact that, you know, it is our need to do so. I think this whole concept of when it becomes a need and then it becomes a resource and then it becomes, again, it commodifies in a different form. Maybe the definition of nature in that process may not be as restrictive as, say, currently just recreation or, like you said, purposes of regulation. But maybe slightly more broader than that. But as long as this idea of need will continue, I think there will be a concern always with managing nature. That's my comment. And in terms of a question, so this is a phenomena that so far, I'm from Delhi and I've been based in Bangalore for 3 years, don't know much about the city, and that's why I try and capture as much as I can. So my friends in Delhi have this this whole phenomena where they let in street dogs, they feed them. Mm-hmm. And you know, the whole idea of very similar concepts that you spoke of today, but more to do with the existing biodiversity in the city, more right. to do with the living beings in the city, and how you, and the same concept of not having, instead of variegated flowers, or plants, not having pets in the house, but actually the ones that actually live in the city be part of your community and, you know, be part of your household, etc. And that's where I think it's very important for me to kind of understand, how do you see this broadening? Because these are ideas that are not just restricted to certain lines or certain narratives of nature. Nature, you know, like, it percolates into every form of our existence, and it has various ways. So how does one take a framework which is not just green infrastructure in that sense, but how do you broaden that? How do you think of it? I mean, as an ecologist, because I'm not at all trained in that sense. Right. Thank you.
So to the first question, that's always a struggle. Do you go with the normative aspects and the rights of nature on its own? Or do you go with the fact that nature has value? And what is a better communication or education strategy? I think both, because, and I also think the line between the two is not really necessarily the hard line we make it out to be, because many people understand that nature has its own right to live, but they also understand that there are practical uses of nature. And especially, I think, in the Indian context, these always came together, because you had sacred traditions of nature worship, but you also used the same nature. You just had rules that in this season you don't use it, or you don't pluck more than this, or, you know, those kinds of things. Some limitations on it, but these two went together. So in that sense, however, even with the argument that people need nature in cities, you have, it seems like the majority that is very difficult, not the majority, but the majority of people who don't engage with nature in their daily lives don't understand why you need nature. So I think going the normative route for in terms of public outreach and getting people on the side, I have not found it to be useful as a dissemination, a communication engagement strategy. What I find to be more useful is practical. So for instance, one of the best, most useful pieces of our research was something that a student of mine actually came up with this idea, saying, let's just look at trees and pollution. And we showed through a set of data how street trees can reduce the amount of air pollution by about 20% of their original levels. That gained a lot of traction because suddenly people see health and see themselves. Otherwise, it comes back to, you know, why all the sentiment about trees in cities, you can't afford to have the sentimental attitude. Street dogs, much more complex issue, because there are a lot of issues with street dogs and other wildlife and human attacks that I'm not, it's very difficult. But what you're talking about is broader than the specifics of street dogs, right? It's a way of interacting with species, which we have seen. So many houses in Indian cities, the first rice of the day, you put ghee and you leave it out for the birds, right? Or you definitely would leave out some water or some sugar for the ants or some milk, you know? So these are all organic traditions that you would have, which may or may not have that much of an impact on specific nature. But the thing it does is it inculcates a way of life, which is a broader thing and helps you figure out that there are there's room for everyone in a city.
I just had a follow-up line, yeah. Just one, not a question, but more like when you say the last part about how it opens up a broader way of, you know, valuing life and you know, all kinds of life. Only question there is, how does that enter into this kind of a dialogue? It's like, how do you structure, not just, I don't mean only species life, I mean even nature, including all forms of mm-hmm. life. How do you include that into a structure or a quest? Like, you know, here you have mapped trees and you've shown how the city changed, mm-hmm. how lakes vanished. Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking, how do you structure something like
so
that?
So I haven't had the time to discuss that and we can talk more, but if you look at the book, for instance, there's a lot in there about how people have engaged with birds and animals and wildlife and what they see has changed and what they engage with more and what they engage with less. So we can talk about that definitely later.
Yeah, thanks, Harini. That was, I mean, I know I keep hearing this and but I have this question and it's just come to me now. It's not actually a question, more of a reflection, but you know, this idea that you said, the idea that when a land is defined as wasteland and then it's, you know, further used, it's given to the government and then government, of course, puts it to some other use. And it's not, of course, unique to Bangalore. It, mm-hmm. It's happening in many other places, right. Porumbok and in Tamil Nadu. That's the definition for wasteland. But I think looking at from the policy perspective, mm-hmm. if we were to take it at a larger scale and to think of how cities are developed mm-hmm. and planned and so on, and if at that level itself, if we were to consider re-looking at this idea of wasteland, I mean, mm-hmm. what really gets defined as a wasteland, and then recognize the role of open land for various other purposes. I mean, I think it's following up on Sahil's point of, you know, utility mm-hmm. and use, and you know, it gives it value. Is there any sort of work that's done on that? Just understanding how patterns of or the nomenclature in land use has changed from one land use to eventually mm-hmm. Getting you know, this terminology of a wasteland, and then how it changes ownership and then leads to a specific use eventually.
Rohan D'Souza did this really nice study on some of the areas around Sarjapur Road on looking at actually a micro case study of these around lakes, how lands are first defined as commons. And then slowly that entire land goes to becoming privatized land. But unfortunately, he never published that. But it's a fascinating story of change. But a broader point is the whole difference between wasteland and commons really points to a lot of confusion, especially at the policy level, between commons and public use. So when you think of areas as commons, and that's what the Supreme Court defines, right? Commons cannot be converted into any other kind of use. But the interpretation, in fact, is that commons are the same as public. Commons use is the same as public use, and public use can therefore be buildings and utility centers and roads and all of these, because these are public uses. Community functions, marriage halls, you know, all of these things. It's a slippery slope there. But they're commons, they're ecological commons, and they have to be retained as such. So there's a lot of confusion about this that really is at the heart, I think, of a lot of this. Yeah. Okay.
It was a fabulous talk, and I was savoring each and every minute of it. I'm an optimist as well, you know, like how you were sharing. In fact, a few months ago, there was an article floating around Facebook how Bangalore is going to be dead in about 5 years or so. But I mean, there are, you know, a lot of success stories, you know, including Kaikundali Lake and everything. So can you like share a little bit more about, you know, like the success stories that have happened, and also what's the way forward? If you can just throw a little bit, little light about, you know, what can we do as well?
So there are others in the room who should also share success stories about lakes. I think we've been working in this area for a much longer time. But I think what I've tried to do is put together, in the, there's so many things in Bangalore. For instance, ESG is, you know, because ESG fought the PIL for lakes, we have this protection of all the lakes, at least now, and we have the current fencing. Because Hasirusiru raised the attention of trees on roads for such a long time, you have this idea that, you know, at least there is a fear on the government side that if you do tree felling, protests will happen. And they know that protests will happen and people will come together. And it, at least in the media, it gets covered. Because of the role of the media, again, a lot of things get covered. So I think there are so many places. One of the things I found personally most moving is a person I talk about in the book, this lady called Honnamma Govindaya from Jayanagar. My friend's grandmother, actually, who was, she's now 91, a mother of 10 children, husband passed away as a single mother, raising children, doing all the housework herself, homemaker. Fought to save a public park in Jayanagar. Her children were grown, but she said that as my children played in the park, other people should play in the park. Other people's children. She didn't get too much support from the community, but she took the case all the way to the Supreme Court eventually. She got people throwing stones in her house. There were times when she was scared to do this alone. She put the case in her son-in-law's name and fought it because people were, you know, getting after her. But the courage with which, and now that place is a park. And so she was telling me, I was asking her once, who inspired you? She said, when she was a child, apparently Gandhi was coming to her village and she heard this and she went running with a little plant that she'd uprooted, and she was barely 5 or 6, and he picked her up and he took the plant from her and put her down, and from then she started wearing khadi and, you know, changing things. And I asked her, I said, how did you find the time? Because we're 10 kids and running a house and doing all of these things and, you know, single parenting. And she said, if you really want to do something, will you not find time for it? And so I think the numbers of people that I have heard these wonderful stories from across Bangalore, that is partly a lot of it which gives the optimism. Because there's so many people who fight so hard. I think the issue is, after you fight so hard, do you get efforts commensurate with that fighting? Probably not, but they're there and they're doing it. So.
Thank you so much. My question is somewhat, I think, a little off this, but I was wondering, you mentioned juggling a lot of different roles while you were conducting your work as a researcher, as a mother, as a citizen, as a participant. I wondered if you ever encountered any conflict between playing these different roles, because I often have this, that one of the reasons why I never do any research work in Malleshwaram is because I've lived there for 20 years, I have too many biases, I have too many hang-ups about the place, so it's very difficult for me to be objective about it. So, have you had similar experiences?
Very interesting question. What I'd like to say, I haven't thought about this too much, but one of the places I write a lot about the social aspect, which is where the whole bias, I won't call it the bias, but the interrelationship become much more woven in the personal. I don't write research papers about that. I've written the book, but I'm fine with writing the book because I'm very clear upfront that this is my bias, this is how I frame it, and I'm writing it as a personal narrative as much as a research piece. My papers, you'll find, are more about the ecology. Occasionally, they're about the institutions, but there, yes, it's always a hard battle to do this. I feel the knowledge helps because you can write about the situation much better, but I declare that upfront. Another colleague of mine who wrote books once told me that it's very difficult for her to go back to writing research papers because they force you to be too objective. And once you get personalized and involved in writing a book, you find it's very difficult to go back to that detached way of analysis. That part I would agree. I'm finding that increasingly hard. So, because if you have to do your research in a sort of sanitized, objective way, it doesn't seem motivating. But that's a very interesting question.
We can quote an example. This old Kolar district or the present Kolar and Chipulapur district put together. Probably you are very much aware of that. It was home to more than a thousand lakes, interconnected lakes. Today, in fact, they say from its birthplace in Nandi Hills up to the point where it crosses into Tamil Nadu, where that Ram Sagara Kerai is there, there are exactly 1,000 lakes on that river feeding water into that. We have destroyed all that. Why I'm telling this is the danger involved in treating this as just our need, or which is a greater need between two sets of needs, no, which is a greater need and destroy the thing for the with the smaller utility. They have destroyed all that, and today we are thinking of bringing water from Ethinole.
Yes.
So it's a tragedy. Instead of that, if we can revive in the next 5 years, all these tanks, it can be revived. If you revive that, the entire problem will be solved. And there will be no need for us to bring water from Ethinole, which we have no right to.
Exactly.
That is what we have to, I think, as a civilizational point, I think we have to think along those lines and decide about it. And this is it. We will not go beyond this. I don't know whether it's possible. We should fight for it. There's one other point, I think, which from the ecological point of view also, it is a very important thing. And we remember in the olden days in Kolar district, the Neergantis were there. You must have heard about them. They were actually managing the water in a tank. And once it was decided by the panchayat, by the entire community, that this is the water available here in this tank of the village, and one man was appointed, and his word was final. Nobody could even talk to him, asking him for some favors or anything like that. That was a kind of social system that was built to cater to the needs of the community. I think that should be one of the ideas around which you should build is commons and all that. That would be a great thing if we can really do it.
So, interesting that you said, because if you look at a lot of the Neergantis, they were absorbed by BWSSB as watermen, but BBMP, BDA don't treat them as anything, right? They've completely gone out of the system. And it's very sad, because if you think of that was a very natural connect that we could have brought into this. But.
So we are almost out of time. If anybody has any last questions, we'll take them now, and otherwise we can wrap up for the day. No? Okay. Thank you so much, Harini. And thank you all for coming. Please do keep coming again. We'll have more talks like this frequently. And you can check the IIHS Facebook page or our Twitter account for announcements about this. We also have a newsletter that we send out to your email accounts if you choose to sign up for it. Thank you.